afternoon. I'm going to be walking around a bit, lots of slides to go through. I'm really excited to be here. When I was given which slot, I chose Friday afternoon. Typically, I'll teach you 9 at this time, so I'll just have your lunch, so hopefully I'm going to get you active, just like I would in my year 9s. Cutting through the waffle. I've got a lot of slides to go through, so I hope I haven't set myself up to fail here. I'm going to just start with a bit of context of what I want to share, and a bit about the school, first of all. And I want you to think about common sense, approaches, workload and well-being. It's on everyone's agendas, and that's my takeaway, really. Teacher talk it, please tweet. I will put my presentation online at the weekend, so don't worry about trying to write everything down now. I want to have this rolling question for you. If you could observe someone teach, who would it be and why? And I'll get you to think, pair, share later in the session. So characteristics, we're in London, central London actually, in the north of Westminster, so actually the street next door is Camden. Our local landmarks, the Beatles, zebra crossings, thrown distance away, London Zoo, Sherlock Holmes, and the American School for London's are our closest school neighbours, and the most expensive school in Britain. So that kind of puts it into context. Some figures. We have a capacity for 1,500 students, 95% ethnic minorities, 83% AAL, 61% pupil premium. So, you know, challenging circumstances. We hit the highest of those quintiles on the Ofsted dashboard. So hopefully that puts into context our school. Just like your school, we have great kids who all deserve the best opportunities in life. This time last year, we saw the buildings as a design technology teacher's fantastic project to actually watch this process take place during my time since I've been at the school over the last year. So it's been very interesting watching the school getting demolished onto a new site. This time last year, we packed absolutely everything away. I remember at one point even having to work out a strategy in terms of deploying remote controls for our new clever touch screens. So absolutely every aspect of moving into a brand new building needed some kind of strategy. £35 million BSF, one of the last to get through. So we're very lucky, our kids are very lucky. In the little plot of green grass at the bottom was a sixth form centre that wasn't part of the original plans, but thankfully 350 of our sixth form, we've got a nice space for them too. Teach Meet London, we did last March, last April. It didn't coincide with everyone's different holidays, but essentially it was most people's Easter holidays. We had 350 people from all over the country come to this event. So it's an invitation if you're down in London, Wednesday, 23rd of March, 2016. It will be the greatest teacher-led CPD event ever. Straw poll, so hands up who, I'm an avid blogger, hands up who blogs. Okay, hands up who's tweeters. Hands up who doesn't do either. Let's see, okay, so a good split. Primary teachers, secondary teachers, FE, consultants, companies. Okay, just a classroom teacher. Okay, I'm going to say that any classroom teachers, no leadership responsibilities. Okay, 1, 2, fantastic, thank you. So characteristics of a waffle. This was in the TS last week. I don't know about you, but it made my blood boil. Members of the government appointed groups investigating how to reduce teacher workload believe the burden could be eased if teachers understood the benefits of what they had to do. Don't know how you feel about that, but that's the headline. Obviously it's the press, so it's a bit of sensationalism. So it's very frustrating to say the least. So how are we losing sight of what's important? Are we doing things for Ofsted? Are we managing rather than leading? Are we evidencing rather than teaching? Don't get me started on that one. Knowledge versus skills, textbooks versus iPads. We're losing sight of things, of what we want to do. So here's an image. What do you see? Are you looking at or looking for? So David Dadao mentioned this in the Ofsted kind of handbook. He was privy to kind of seeing a bit of terminology. And the changing of at towards for totally changes the perspective of observing teachers. And we need to move from this model of the top left to the top bottom right, where things that we do are reliable and valid. So to cut the waffle, improving teacher well-being. Teacher learning should trump everything that we do. Everything. We need to keep it simple. It's so easy to overcomplicate things. So I'm going with the model Mark Plan Teach, which I'll explain later. But we need to demand high expectations too. Remove bureaucracy, evidence trails. So I'm going to show you some of the things that I've done too. What can offset source in 2 days? You know? Well-being and priority is a challenge. It's a big priority in my school. It's a big priority for everyone. Consolidate all the different curriculum reforms, exam changes. Okay, there's so much that teachers need to do in the classroom to get their heads around. We need to consolidate and slow down. And it's certainly been the case where I work. And then, you know, we've all got experts in the school. We need to look more inside rather than outside. But the current landscape was divided when I last talked about this a year ago. Ofsted or ourselves, I firmly believe that partly a lot of bloggers have a bit to do with this, we freed the burden lesson gradings. But I wonder in the room where we all sit. So do we grade or not grade lessons? I shared this tweet a year ago, and you can see it's asked, so it was from an ASCL conference, and there's been various other things since, but essentially you can see the vast majority of people, about 26% at the time, where schools went to no grade models. I believe it's approximately 50%. So can I have a hands up in the room? Hands up which schools do not grade lessons. Okay, so I would say that's the vast majority. Okay, thank you. Running thought, if you could observe someone, who would it be and why? I'm going to take you back through a timeline. So just before I started working in February, Quinton Kinniston in February, what we may have been used to in the past, feedback would have been based on this. The vast majority of the focus in a teacher's life would be putting it on the observation, that one-off performance. The full-time classroom teacher, we need to remind ourselves, they work typically 20 hours a week, 38 weeks a year, 760 hours. But we only judge them on 3 of those hours, or typically. So how do we do that? And then we would put them in a box, and then we'd share that with Ofsted, we'd give them a grade, we'd give a percentage. But maybe we should start to look at quality in different ways. So I'm going to kind of suggest different models to you today. And as a result of that dialogue online, with, you know, Tom Sheridan, who was here yesterday, David Dow, Tom Bennett, and Sheena Lewington, we were invited to Ofsted, I think online we were called the Famous Five, which was far from it. It was a landmark. Ofsted, the DfE, started to get teachers into the boardrooms, round tables, and start to hear our views. And from that point, Mike Clavenog, who's the ex-director, suggested no more grades on the evidence trail forms. So we had no more grades, and it was great. There was a pilot in the Midlands in June 2014, a report they've still yet to publish, so I hasten to add. And then in September 2014, we had no grades. So I like to think that it's now, this is the predicted model now, where we're looking at over time rather than the one-off performance. And in the school, first thing I did in position, as appointed the deputy head, September 2014, we were brave, we removed lesson grading straight away. However, there's no silver bullet in this presentation. I don't know all the answers, I'm just sharing what I do. Okay, we've all got a lot of expertise in this room. And what just works for me might not work for you. So there'll be things you might want to take away, things that you might just think are a load of nonsense. An open versus closed model. What is a good teacher? Have a think to yourself, what is a good teacher? And this question a bit harder. How do you know? So here's some suggestions. Open versus closed, formative versus summative. To develop, to inform, to support students. And closed, to measure teachers, to report on teacher quality. So how do you evidence good teaching? So we've got the open-closed model. So government, give or take £1 million here or there, £80 billion across the country. We're always going to be held to account. We've got the teacher standards, we've got a framework for appraisal capability. Then we've got this open model that we're trying to aspire towards in schools, on the ground. What is a good teacher? How do we know how to do evidence? So we're in a bit of a dichotomy all the time. Okay, and the impact that it has on individual teachers in classrooms. So I'm going to give you 30 seconds to share and compare with each other. How do you evidence the quality of teaching in your school? Go. Okay, so it's complicated. And there's probably lots of different models in the room. So here's my suggestion, progress over time. So again, a bit more terminology, not a framework impacting all of us across the nation. But I move away from one-off classroom performance towards more valid sources. So I'm going to explain some of the things that I've done in my leadership role, but here's a diagram. You can see teaching is one part of it. Student books, looking at work samples, talking to kids, looking in the books. The teacher-owned data, so you've got a document that I'm going to come back to in a moment, our learning policy. I've talked about the open and closed model on the bottom right, but we use the term typicality, so schools might do it differently. We have senior leaders, middle leaders walk around the school all the time, supporting and challenging where needed, and kind of getting a feel for the school, typically. Especially you've got your hot spots and your cold spots, bright spots, whatever you want to call them, to see how your teaching is typically. And then most important, student conversations. So those are the things that we're looking at, and I'm hoping that this term to come, we're going to start to push student conversations a lot more as a valid source. But what it's not a single lesson, and it's not one-off judgments. It's certainly not in my opinion. And there's a great quote from Kevin Barth, who's a Canon's Park head teacher down in West London. There is no progress within the lessons, there is only learning. Ofsted framework, it talks about skills and understanding that inspectors will be looking to see from the students. Okay, where progress is mentioned, it's not something inspectors look at from the students, but it's about effectiveness of monitoring that they will be looking to see from the teacher. So hence the data. And you'll notice in the learning policy that you hopefully picked up at the door, you'll see in the mark section a secure overview. So September 17th, 2014, I would call it my lottery day come up. So after a lot of blogging, I was very happy that Ofsted, strangely, came to visit. It was my third week in post. In a new school, and we were the information we're going to share is very interesting. So there's an impact on achievement versus teaching and learning, and given the new landscape that we're in, it's very interesting. It's very significant. So often liked what they saw in our classrooms, but our headline results didn't determine our overall teaching and learning grade, and if our results would have been higher, then so would our judgment on teaching and learning. Okay? Fair enough. Are we looking at a qualitative or quantitative model here of teaching? Not just within schools, but also externally. If outcomes require improvement, then teaching and learning cannot be better. So the question is, what significance would actually no grading have anyway on an overall judgment? Tom yesterday, he didn't say this, but he said this to me in the past. He once attended a conference where a senior leader said that 85% of his lessons were good or better. So are we losing sight of our professionalism? So in the room it looks like we're moving to a new model, which is good. And then he said this, lessons are more normal, you see more regular lessons, people tell me so, they fret less, there's more open door cultures, and you start to see a typical pattern of what's going on around the school. And it's a much more supportive model. So, just briefly, 30 more seconds, if you could observe someone, who would it be and why? Think, share to each other, thank you very much. Who would you observe? Good teacher, bad teacher, you decide. Stephen, and because I know you from the spot, who would you observe and why?
I'd go see John
Thompson. John Thompson. Anyone else want to call out who you would observe and why?
You.
Excellent, thank
Tom
you.
Tom Bennett, behaviour
science. Tom Bennett. One more, please, this side.
Head of English at London North School after this presentation today.
Okay, great, thank you. Okay, so January. Nuts and bolts. So, a term in. First term in post, requires improvements, lots to do. If you know Quinton Kinnison, we've had a lot of press coverage for lots of different things. It's been very stressful on our staff. So we're trying to support our staff, trying to encourage them to take more risks. At the same time, we've got external pressures, not just the media, but also in terms of how we're judged. So towards the landscape of that lesson grade, so a challenge for us all. looking at rather than looking for is a much better model. But how do we train people to be able to do that, to be reliable and valid? Okay, so a lot of investment is needed. And that we give sophisticated feedback, not just to our students, but also to our teachers, so they can actually improve, and they've given time to do that, and that we revisit that regularly. Okay, not just three times a year. So the challenge, remove the fear. Okay, now it's difficult when we've got the closed model where there's accountability, there's teacher standards. We need to have some kind of standards. Risk taking, you know, the learning policy I'm going to talk about briefly towards the end is, you know, it's risk taking. I don't want it to stifle creativity. We want staff to do their own thing, but we want to have a common approach in certain aspects. And then establishing coaching and mentoring. So we invest in Iris, Iris Connect, the video coaching system. And we're not stipulating that everyone has to do it. We're starting slowly, hopefully by sharing best practice staff. When the fear dissipates, we'll start to want to observe each other. So these are some of the tools that we've used to help bring all the nuts and bolts together. Mint classes, seating plans, you'll see that on our planning section of the learning policy. Full matrix to help teachers get a secure overview of their own data. And blue sky for our teachers to record all their CPD events and their observations. Okay, the other aspect of that, if you're familiar with blue sky, it allows you to collect all your evidence and things like that for your appraisal. Lesson study, good model, a huge amount of time to be invested. Some models where I've seen it work is that staff are paired up in twos or threes, and they regularly meet every 15 minutes once a week to keep topping up all the different aspects of their observations and feedback. So it's a nut that I've yet to crack in my new school, but that's where we want to go this next term, is to start to develop some models for triangulating, planning together, observing together, and reflecting. In April, blogging again, Sean thankfully gave me a one-to-one, very kind of him. You know, for me, this is evidence of what blogging can get to. You can get to round tables and start to have discussions. These are some of the things we talked about. And my issue at the time, when I blogged about an invalid judgment from Ofsted's point of view, was that they looked at arrays online, which is right now, this time last year, unvalidated data. When I met with Sean in April, there was schools in the same context, same background, same results, but had a totally different Ofsted judgment. His one sentence was this. He said, there will always be 1% of error because humans are involved. And it's not reliable, then, is it? It's not 100% reliable. And there you have schools that a judge requires improvement for whatever reasons, we're still using a model that's not quite robust. So, what is good? Good teachers, you'll have your views, these are mine, the subject experts. Okay, we need to top up our knowledge all the time, curriculum reform. We need staff time to consolidate the CPD in departments. We have weekly CPD every Wednesday. We collapse our timetable by one period. Sometimes it's all together, sometimes it's differentiated, sometimes it's in faculties. And we make sure that they get regular time to consolidate knowledge. Open classrooms, so doors open, we have these signs around. We ask staff to kind of showcase or celebrate the things that they're doing. And we want them to keep reflecting, which is the next one. I firmly believe reflection is a default characteristic for all teachers, and that's what I started to do online. And you know, people in the room that read my blog will know that I like to reflect regularly. And it kind of leads to you developing your own repertoire. Teachers accept no nonsense. They cut through the waffle. Okay, they've got high standards. They own their territory. You know, even the most difficult kids. They don't jump through hoops. They take risks. Good teachers. Okay, and you know, there's no. I used to have several thoughts about maverick teaching, and at one point I would probably consider myself to be, but you know, through my experience now I start to observe thousands and thousands of lessons. There is a place for teachers to be somewhat maverick, but not if it's going against what the whole school is trying to achieve. So there's a time and a place. All teachers need to engage with CPD, but schools must give mechanisms for teachers to be able to do that. And we need to collaborate and share. Because there's so much expertise within our schools, and sometimes teachers just need that unlocked so that they can then get to be greater. Lots of this going on, action research. This was our journal, What Works. Our first time, we probably had about 15 teachers write a publication. We had 15 different workshops this time in June last year, sharing what works with their projects through MPQML, MPQSL, MAs, PhDs, and things like that. So that was fantastic. We hope to get two of those out this academic year. run in thought. Again, if you could observe someone else, who would it be and why? So this year, the message that people are pushing to our staff is this: don't waste your time. There are a lot of things that are wasting people's time. Staff that are working 60-hour weeks. So marking is broken. And I think it's not just in my school, I think it's nationally. And I've blogged about this before. You know, the funding formula thing is a different aspect, but until policy changes where teachers have less than 90% of the timetable in a classroom, we get more time to mark and plan, nothing's going to change. I just think it's going to be waffle, more waffle from the government. So five key stakeholders in marking: parents, senior leadership, inspectors, teachers, and the child. Parents love marking, so they get a pair of red lips. Senior leadership love marking too, big pair of lips. Inspectors get the biggest. Teachers cry in the corner, child in the middle, not really knowing what's going on, doesn't get feedback, doesn't know how to improve. So marking's broken. And this came out through, I think, David Dow, Stephen Lockyer, online through blogs. Plan, teach, mark was the original model. We all go to university, train to become a teacher, we go through these laborious lesson plans, we're told we have to plan to the lesson, stick to the lesson. Then we teach it, and then we mark our books afterwards. But by flipping the model, it totally changes how you approach your lesson planning. So that's why our learning policy, that you should hopefully have a copy, works in that way. To mark, to inform your planning, and then your planning to actually allow you to be able to teach. 1 year ago, I posted these tweets. Progress over time and the removal of lesson breaks, has it been replaced with redrafting the frenzy or the marking? So I blogged a while ago about the marking frenzy. You can see the results for itself, and it's an old tweet now, but it's pretty conclusive that it's the new thing, it's the new workload frenzy. So is marking and acting feedback the new vogue? I think it is. And as a result, progress over time has now triggered the marking frenzy. So how do we address this marking frenzy? Start to focus on what's important yet again. So priorities in my school. Here's our learning, teaching and learning policy. It's a one-page summary. Behind it will be the detail. Now, already this detail is 20 pages long, and I know no one's going to read it. So I've got to make it concise. I've got to cut the waffle out and go straight to the point. So we've moved to Google. We're a Google school, and it's superb for workload. There's no more saving version 12, version 13, version 14 of different documents. As you work, it's there online and it's live. And the first week of us using that in September, you can see staff start to collaborate on the same presentation, the kids too. It was just superb. So if you're not using Google, I would highly advocate it for you. You can see on this document, you haven't got it on your sheet of paper, but the blue hyperlinks lead to information behind, so examples of, or photos of, and things like that. And we hope the one-page summary will be in classroom displays, it will be in our teacher planners, and the staff will know it. Not our students necessarily, but our staff. And again, I want to emphasise that we don't want everyone to do the same model, we want to have some consistency to help raise standards. We introduced an MER cycle, it was unknown in the school, but more importantly, to study the workflow and the workload, so staff knew what would come in terms of trying to improve the things that we did. So that's on my blog if you want to grab a copy. But in terms of mark, here's the first section of the mark policy. Secure overview, teachers knowing their data inside out, okay, the student progress. Formative, so we introduced the yellow box. Again, it doesn't have to be yellow, it's just a mechanism for direct feedback in student books, and it allows the teachers, I'll show you some examples, it allows the teachers just to focus on one aspect of the work rather than marking everything. Marking should be regular. Before we edited this, it said 6 and 12 and all different numbers if you're an art teacher versus a maths teacher, because you show the students at different lengths of time. So we just change it, regular, that's it. If marking's not happening, then it's not regular. How you define that is up to the curriculum, it's proportionate to the curriculum time. And then the marking code. Now, on a recent work sample, which I'll show you, we found that the marking code is still developing. And again, we're not going to beat teachers over the stick. We want teachers to mark books, but more importantly, we want students to act in the feedback that they receive. So, a reminder about marking. Hattie, feedback, we know if it's meaningful, sophisticated, it can aid progress significantly. And Mary Myatt, brilliant. High quality, not truckloads of tips, fewer things done really well. I only looked at books a couple of weeks ago, a new marking policy, and still I've got teachers just ticking, absolutely wasting their time and no value to the student whatsoever. So it's just best not to do it. Ofsted does not expect to see a frequency. Ofsted does not expect unnecessary written dialogue. I've written about verbal feedback stamps. They might work for you, My opinion, I don't think they work. Verbal feedback should be verbal. You shouldn't be stamping books to prove something for someone else. Okay? That's my opinion. So should you be marking every work? No, you shouldn't. How often should I expect to see feedback? When it's needed. Okay, we've got to give teachers a bit of trust, and we've got to let them do it. So how would you reduce the marking burden for teachers in your school? What ideas would you have? 30 seconds, please. Go. Yellow box. So great idea. The yellow box indicates the area that you're going to make your improvements in. So it's for the teacher and for the students. Size of the box can determine how many improvements can be made. So here's some examples. These are 2 weeks ago from our work sample. So you can see the yellow box, students put in the work, no evidence that the teacher has acted on there, so no evidence that the teacher's looked at that at the moment. Okay, so interesting. And again, keep in mind evidence trails, you know, triple marking, those kind of issues too. Here's an English example. You know, you'd expect lots of marking code, our marking code we use, you can see a stamp, good work. It's a green box, I'm not going to be fussy what colour it is, I'm not going to go into different coloured pens. Just common sense. Then you can see the space, so a bit of the marking code, space for students to actually act on the feedback given. So what we found is it doesn't matter what we're asking, ultimately we want to see the student act on that feedback. This is an old form, and I blogged about this a couple of weeks ago, it caused a bit of controversy with a few people. So this has evolved over the last 5 years from my point of view. This is an old one. This is the most recent one, but now I'm going to actually tweak it further just to have question two. Is there evidence of acting on feedback? Nothing else is needed. Because if that's not happening, there's no marking taking place. Marking code would pretty be obvious. And the yellow box is a mechanism to allow the acting on feedback to happen. Then there's the issue of practical subjects that don't have books. So that needs to be taken into account too. So we've used this form, we did another version, so we did high, middle, low. This was for observations, going into the room, talking to the teacher, getting the backstory, talking to the kids, finding out what's going on, why is it just one piece of work, you've been here for 6 weeks. We have another form, we took 15 students across Ski Stage 3. We did a sample with the teacher and the learning team, we invited middle leaders, we invited senior leaders, and many people that have spoken to me have said that they found it very, you know, first time many of them had done it, but they found it a very, very interesting and valuable process. So the next stage is to introduce this into our Wednesday night CPD. Bring your best books, that's fine, but let's have a look at how your marking is developing to help yourself, your workload, and also help the students. We iris the students, so we've triangulated, we've gone to observations, and we looked in lessons, we've talked to the teacher and the students, we've taken books out of class into a room, and then we've also sat and interviewed the students too. So we're going to share this footage with our staff in January. Again, if you could observe someone, who would it be and why, keep coming to think. So onto the plan, again, keep telling staff, don't waste your time. This is my lesson plan example from about 2008, so 7 or 8 years ago. When I first started my new job, sat down with the inspector, opened up the file that I'd been given, because I'd only been there 3 weeks, and to my horror, there was 3-page lesson plans in there. Why? Because it might have been the old model, it's how we bring up our NQTs, it's what we're told at university, and there's an issue there, I think, because what happens there is not in reality what actually happens on the ground. And the need to plan will never go away. So if you look in the plan section, evidence of planning. Doesn't mean a lesson plan. I don't want to have lesson plans. I don't, a middle leader observed me the other day. They said, I've got a lesson plan. I was smart and said no. 5-minute lesson plan. So, you know, something I've driven quite a lot. On the left, you've got DKL, so Jude Enright, Deputy Head in West London, doorknob lessons. On the right-hand side, you've got the 3-page laborious lesson plans. And in the middle, you've got the 5-minute lesson plan. And what I believe is great about it is It focuses on what's important, obviously the cognition in your head, the thinking behind the lessons is a lot more detail. But if you're desperate for something, some kind of framework to write down to share with someone, if you wish to do so, it's a great model. Stickability I'll come back to later in the top right hand corner. If I had offered tomorrow, I would probably tell my teachers not to give any lesson plans whatsoever. I'd make them hopefully consider this as an option, but again, I'd tell them not to waste the time. So there's our planning. Be clear and precise. Deborah Pidd, who's wrote the book Notes from a Frontline, talked about lesson objectives. Students waste 30 plus hours a year copying lesson objectives, lesson to lesson. But two we find quite important, the why test. You're doing this, why? And it's amazing, you know, even when my head teacher, Alex Athan, asked me, why are you doing this in your lesson? It makes you think, and that's the part that needs to happen before the actual lesson takes place, the cognitive side. Evidence of long-term planning, so it's from schemes of work, curriculum plans, not one-off lessons. Quality-first approach. What the teacher does in the classroom in the first instance is what makes the biggest impact. Okay, differentiation over time, not in a one-off lesson. Seating plans, I've said in class, we want to know where our students are going to be sitting, so we want them to build in some routines and some typicality. But it's not a free-for-all until teachers get to that place where they can start to take risks, start to be creative. And no dead time, flying start. So hopefully if we have time, I'm going to introduce an idea that you can use as a flying start. Our teacher plan answers are first version. Of this, we don't want everyone to use it. We have some staff want to do online kind of planning, that's fine, but we want evidence of over time. The teach, doesn't matter who, NQT or an experienced teacher like myself, we should all be tweaking our approaches to teaching and learning. This is the culture I want to establish at Quinton and Kinniston. Keep telling them not to waste the time. We're still finding, you know, from the book sample, there's still teachers wasting the time adding to their workload. We're all teachers of literacy, so in our lessons and our teaching, you know, we accept teaching as a lifetime craft, but we want us to be razor sharp, and we want people to be explicit about the outcomes. Keywords, it could just be one keyword. It might be breaking down that keyword, the definitions, where the words originated from, how it links to prior or future knowledge. To go with the learning, this is the risk-taking side of things. It's more important than a learning plan. If kids get stuck on something or you want to veer off the lesson plan, we want our teachers to do that. And you know, Jim Smith, the lazy teacher, working harder than the teacher. I spoke to all my students last week in assemblies, and I'm trying to drill it into them. You should be working harder than the teacher. And then finally, stickability, ensuring learning has stuck, and testing it. Testing to actually see if the learning has stuck. Doesn't mean regular plenaries. It just means that the student, you actually know if something is coming back to the class the next lesson. So, you should have a blank piece of plain paper with you. If you don't, could you grab one? Or use the back of the learning policy, or grab a pen? And could you write numbers 1 to 10 on it? This is an example of a fly start I like to do in my class. It works really well. It's something you could introduce to your own staff. It certainly gets kids active, it helps them settle, it allows them to focus on literacy. Allows them to focus on prior knowledge or things to come. So, numbers 1 to 10, everybody. Be prepared to let go of your paper at some point. You might want to write your name on it and where you're from. Okay. 1 to 10. I want you to spell these words, please. A little spelling test Friday afternoon. Thank you for listening. Okay, word 1, waffle. Can you spell waffle for me? Waffle. Word 2. Workload. Word 3. Well-being. With or without hyphen, you decide. Okay. Now what I'd like to do, crunch it into a snowball and log it across the room. 10 seconds, go. 10. 9, 8, 7, 6, you need to find another piece of paper, sorry, I didn't tell you the full rules. 4, 3, 2, 1. In my class, if you don't have a piece of paper, paper, you're out. You have to wait till the next round. Okay, open the piece of paper up. Can you spell check those three words? Bit of literacy. Spell check those words, and if they're incorrect, go through the knots. If they are, cross them out and rewrite the correct spelling, please. 20 seconds to get organised, and then we've got some more words coming up. Write your name on it, where you're from. Should be two people's names on the paper now, hopefully. Start to say hello to each other. Include the hashtag SSATNC15. Tweet a photo. Right, word four. Keep up. Simplicity. Simplicity. Word five. Priorities. Priorities. Word six. Teacher. Ten. Nine. Eight. Seven. Six. Five. Four. Three. Two. One. Grab a paper, open it up, put your name on it, where you're from. Spell check words 1 to 6, please. And then we're going to do words 7 to 10 to finish off. It's a great little idea if you take it back to your schools. I watched a languages teacher in my couple of schools go do this in class. It was superb, so I've nicked it. That's great. Okay, you've got six words. Can you spell check on six? Hopefully they're pretty easy. If they're not, cross them out. If they're spelled incorrectly, re-correct them. Okay, last, we're going to do four more words. Word seven, mark. Word eight, plan. Word nine, teach. And word ten, trust. Easy peasy, 10 seconds, go. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Grab a bit of paper. It's yours to keep. Tweet a photo later on. Careful. Okay. So, what I do in my classroom, I have a little visualizer. IPEVA are very good for that on your desk. Get the kids to throw it into a bin, or try and hit you on the head, header it in the bin, open them up, and you give out credits or points or stickers, whatever you do in your school, for the kids to get all the right words. Not everyone hits the bin, it allows you not to waste your time, so you can just focus on the ones that meet the target. It's a great little activity for kids. Flying start. So, teaching clarity, quality of teaching. Teaching clarity, stickability, I talked about earlier. This is the so why test. What do you want students to learn and why? Stickability. For me now, my lesson plan just focuses on this solely. What do I want students to stick? What do I want to take away? What do I want them to bring back? So to finally finish off, if you could observe someone, who would it be and why? Now, we've all given our answers, but my answer is myself, not from an egotistical point of view, but if we have mechanisms in place, such as IRIS, coaching and mentoring, where staff can have some kind of tool to be able to watch their own teaching, that surely is going to be the best way that they can improve their own teaching. There's no better feedback than watching yourself. So I'm sure there's more cheaper version. IRIS is expensive, and there's other platforms out there and other tools, but I'm sure we can all get away and give teachers the time to be able to observe each other teach and themselves more explicitly. So that's my answer. So film yourself. And if you look after your staff look after your skills. So that's hopefully what we're aspiring towards, and from a blogging point of view, hopefully I've kind of shown a little bit of evidence that people blog will know that if we can organise ourselves, we can move policy, and we can start to see people get into round tables, which is great, people expressing their views online. The DfE, you know, I have through Twitter the DfE often and Ofcom, they do tell me, I get a bit of feedback, which is great. You know, the DfE tell me that they find it difficult to connect with senior teachers across the country, which is quite frightening, really. But SLT chat, the Twitter account that I've kind of co-created with a few people, trends on Twitter regularly. Why? Because teachers want to share, or senior teachers specifically, the key issues that are important for all of us. So let's cut through the waffle. Thank you, everyone.